Hello everyone, myself Durgeshwari Kalal, working as an assistant professor at R.C. Patel Institute of Pharmaceutical Education and Research. Today, I am going to submit the last video and last task of our international FDP on environment and sustainability organized by T.Y. Patel College of Engineering, Akurdi. My special thanks to Dr. Vinay Kulkarni sir for arranging such a interesting FDP in this pandemic situation. I really enjoyed this FDP and all the session. Thank you. Today I am discuss about the environment and sustainability in pharmaceutical products. Let's start. In week 1 video, I have discussed about the pharmaceutical and personal care products as a pollutants. Here, the various pharmaceutical and personal care products used by individual and how these products are harmful and how the pollutants created by these products are really harmful and affecting the environment. How these PPCPS enter the environment through use and disposal. And also these PPCPS are occurring in our nation's water bodies. This is about week 1. And in week 2, I have discussed about pharmaceutical product in water, a global concern. Means, after using the pollutants created from these pharmaceutical products are showing in the waterways. And wide variety of drugs are polluting our water supply. And what types of drugs are really a pollutants and how these drugs are came from the industries, hospitals and how this entering our environment and really our aquatic life is at a risk and how one should prevent this from occurring. This is about week 2. So today the outcome of my video is discussing about the various ISO standard for pollution due to pharmaceutical industries. One should follow these standards to eliminate the pollution completely. Second is evaluate global greenhouse gas emission. Greenhouse gas emission by the various pharmaceutical industries, that is carbon footprint. And last one is illustrate the LCA based environmental sustainability assessment approach. Here, various ISO standards for pharmaceutical and personal care products. First one is ISO 11930, cosmetics, evaluation of antimicrobial protection of cosmetic product, means to protect the cosmetic products from the microbes. ISO 12787, analytical methods are used for the validation of cosmetics. ISO 16.28, guidelines on technical definition and criteria for natural and organic cosmetic ingredients to put control on companies regarding the ingredients of product. ISO 17.27, analytical approach for screening and quantification methods for heavy metals in the cosmetic. One should limit the use of heavy metal occurring in the cosmetic products. Then these are the ISO standards for the water quality, means how these pharmaceutical pollutants are occurring in our water bodies and how these pollutants are contaminating our water quality. First one is ISO 21676, determination of dissolved fraction of selected active pharmaceutical ingredients to maintain the water quality. Then ISO 7875, determination of non-ionic surfactant using drag and drop reagent, means many of our pharmaceutical products such as soap contains the surfactants. And after using these soaps, the surfactants are dissolving in our water and really this contaminate our water. So By using drag and drop reagent, we can determine this non-ionic surfactant, and one can evaluate the effect of surfactant and its impact on the water content. Next one is ISO 8245, guidelines for determination of total organic carbon and dissolved organic carbon. How much of carbon is dissolving in our water? And again, the determination of carbon content in the water. Next one is ISO 21676, water quality, determination of dissolved fraction of selected API, that is active pharmaceutical ingredients and other organic substances in our water. Means how these API and organic substances are contaminating our water. So, one should follow these ISO standards for preventing our environment from the pollution. Then, next point is carbon footprint. What is meant by carbon footprint? Carbon footprint is defined as the total amount of greenhouse gases produced by the pharma industries to directly and indirectly support the human activities. This is usually expressed in equivalent terms of carbon dioxide. Harmful chemicals in and around chemical industries causes cancer, reproductive damage, breathing problems such as asthma, and birth defects such as well as other health problems such as headache, nausea, dizziness and stress. Chemical industries are also a major sources of gas that causes the global warming. Air pollution and climate change are two closely connected environmental concerns. The major source of global climate change is changes in the atmospheric composition. India is making swift progress in terms of economic development, but it has also caused change in air quality to reach a global scale. So, how these pharma industries are really responsible for this greenhouse gas emission? Here, I have considered these three major greenhouse gas emitters. I have considered three industries, that is steam cracker, ammonia plant and adipic acid plant. The greenhouse gas, that is carbon dioxide emitted from these companies, is really harmful for our environment. Then global CO2 emissions from the industry, different industries, that is iron and steel, cement, petrochemicals, aluminium, paper and others. Here there is the CO2 emission from these major industries, and also a multi prolonged approach is needed. Cutting chemical industry emission could have a huge impact globally. A multi prolonged approach will be necessary to achieve this. The benefits could spread far beyond the chemical sector. The chemical industry has a vital role to play in the climate discussion. On the one hand, chemical products are essential to many low carbon technologies, including renewable energy, housing and mobility. Moreover, chemistry will be needed to develop resistant materials adapted to more severe weather conditions. On the other hand, chemical production is energy and CO2 intensive. This is why this sector is classified as hard to abate. Here, there is total greenhouse gas emission due to chemical industry. Here, there is graphical representation of greenhouse gas emission due to the chemical industries. Then, here there is a scenario for global greenhouse gas emission. This greenhouse gas emission typically rises our temperature. Here I have given the graphical representation for rising of temperature due to the GHG emission. CO2 emission factor. Next point is CO2 emission factor. CO2 emission factors, carbon footprint calculation requires detailed information about the pollution source. A useful property to know is the CO2 emission factor of the source. This factor expresses the mass of CO2 emitted for a given quantity of activity. Here there is a formula for CO2 emission factor. CO2 emission factor is equal to 1/4 of mass of CO2 emitted divided by the quantity of activity. Then here there are CO2 emission factors for the gaseous hydrocarbons and fossil fuels is expressed into the table for methane, ethane, propane, natural gas and flare gas. Here I have considered the CO2 emission from the ammonia production. eCO2 is equal to Fe into Fr into CCF into COF into 44 divided by 12 minus R CO2. Here eCO2 means emission of CO2 in kg. Fe means ammonia production. That is, I have considered the case study for ammonia production. Ammonia production in tons. Fr, that is fuel requirement per unit of output. CCF, that is carbon content factor of the fuel in kg per C divided by GJ. COF, that is carbon oxidation factor of the fuel, and RCO2, that is CO2 recovered for the downstream use. Calculating the carbon footprint is fundamental to understand how an organization activities impact global sustainability. The main challenge is how to calculate it when environmental aspects are intangible assets. Then, last point of discussion is sustainability computation and standard. There can be many methods that may be practiced which may help in absorbing toxic metals and harmful emission around us without affecting the health. So, here there are some physical methods which we can use to eliminate this emission. That is cyclone separator, fabric filter bagels, limestone wet scrubbing system for flue gas desulfuration, electrostatic precipitator, oxidizer, overhead pneumatic cleansers and cloth filters. So we can use these physical methods to eliminate this emission. Here there is a life cycle management in pharmaceutical industry using an applicable and robust LCA based environmental sustainability assessment approach. Here there is a generic life cycle of pharmaceutical product. That is, first step is raw material extraction, then production of basic chemicals. Here we have used the energy, that is electrical energy, in operating materials, that is oil. In production we have used the oil, then for transport. Then API synthesis, that is active pharmaceutical ingredients. Here also we are using energy, that is galenic formulation, operating materials. Then there is a packaging. Also here in case of raw materials, we have used the wastewater treatment. That is waste treatment, exhaust gas treatment, wastewater treatment, etc. Then in last case, distribution, use and disposal. This is the typical generic life cycle of a pharmaceutical product. So here I have concluded my discussion. So thank you. Again, in conclusion, we can say that sustainable chemistry as the design, manufacture and use of efficient, effective, safe and more environmentally benign chemical products and process within the broad framework of sustainable development. Government, academia and industry should strive to maximize resource efficiency through activities such as energy and non-renewable resource conservation, risk minimization, pollution prevention, minimization of waste at all stage of product life cycle, and development of product that are durable and can be reused and recycled. Thank you.